an assent to the world that we are also human beings. We feel pain. When you face a situation that you believe is being caused by you not having all those rights which are due to somebody who is a human being, you start to ask yourself, what has made me, what has placed me under the situation that I am like an animal, like a slave? And those are the questions that we face because we are nothing less than slaves in that entity called man today. So when we sat down and look at this thing, the reality facing us, we discover that the only way to change the situation under which we are being treated is to be sovereign, to control, to have to take our destiny in our own hands, control our own lives in the land of Abel. And as a human being, as a nation, with internationally recognized boundaries and with all the UN resolutions governing trust territories under which we fell, we believe that we have to do that. That's why we need our sovereignty. The Southern Cameroon Youth League, actually the acting chairman of the Youth League. This is an organization that came out from the aspiration and the determination of the youths of the Southern Cameroons. When I say youths, shouldn't confuse it like with an age group. But it started that way, but the ideals of the organization some sort of crystallized in bringing in a lot of people whom under normal circumstances you would not consider as youth. But it is these ideals, the ideal of actually having sovereignty over our land, that propels this organization and that motivates us and provides the engine for us. We sat down and asked ourselves that why is this debate of our sovereignty being carried on in boardrooms? Because that is not where the struggle for our liberation is. That struggle is down in the streets. And that is the essence of the Youth League, to bring that struggle down to our people.
Now, what is wrong with boardrooms?
We believed, and have believed for a long time, that in no way and in no situation would we ever be able to succeed in what we are doing if we continue holding those meetings in boardrooms. Because other people and other situations have shown us in the world that that will never happen. That has never been able to win freedom for any people in this world. It is when you take it out of the boardrooms, down into the street, to face the reality of the situation, that people have been able to prevail.
Now, you talked about sovereignty. You want sovereignty from whom?
The world understands what we are facing, that we are under annexation from La République du Cameroun, said situation caused by the British running away from their role, which was to get sovereignty for us, as France did for the other trust territory, La République du Cameroun. Britain did not do that. They instead exchanged one colonizer with another, from Britain colonizing us to La République today colonizing us. So our whole fight is to throw up that yoke of colonization which La Republique has placed on her neck, La Republique du Cameroun.
What has lack of sovereignty done to you as an individual or a country?
As a country today, my people face genocide. It has been going on for a long time. And why it has been quiet is because our people have not started fighting back. But the time has come for our people to fight back. And when we start fighting back, that's when the world will know the extent of the genocide that is being perpetrated on our people. More than 50% of our people believe that the Lignos disaster was a chemical weapon that was tested on our territory. And that's true. La Republique du Cameroun does that to use our people as guinea pigs, to come into our secondary schools and use sterilization to inject students so that the population of the Anglophones should not increase. And that is how little by little they have been dealing with our people. We don't have hospitals. That has tripled, more than tripled, the death rate of our people. Taking the situation of the death rate in La Republique du Cameroun and the death rate in the Anglophone region of Cameroun or the southern Cameroons, you discover that the disparity is so wide because of the government mechanization, the genocide that they are perpetrating against our people. And if there is any of our people today who believes that we are not at war, he should look at such statistics. Then he should know that we have been at war for a long time. And it is now time for every one of us who considers himself, first of all, as a human being, not even a Southern Cameroonian or an Ambazonian, as a human being, to ask himself a simple question, that as a human being, if you cannot stand against such human degradation, and fight against, can you consider yourself a human being? It is time for us to stand up and assert to the world that we are also human beings. We feel pain.
Well, you talk of fighting back. How do you intend to fight back?
I think that the most logical thing for any of us to do is to stop those Turks and murderers running around in our territory free. When they go out, they kill our people, they enter into our beer parlors and they drink and they laugh about it. We should take away that smile from their faces. We should tell them that for any one Southern Cameroonian that they kill, they will also face a reaction, that they won't go free, that they won't get into our beer parlors and drink and laugh on our heads. We should do that. That is what the U League stands for. We will not tolerate those marauders again. What are we doing? Have we no guts? Can't we fight for something? What can you do? What have we done? The chairman of the Youth League is in jail. He was hijacked. He's now a hostage in La Republique du Cameroun. Because he had the guts to stand up and tell these people that enough is enough. And that is what we believe that every Southern Cameroonian, every Ambazonian should do.
Now, you talked about your chairman. Tell me a little more about your chairman. What's his name and where is he right now?
That's Ebenezer Akwanga Bongo Jr. He is in the maximum security prison, Kondengi, in Yaoundé. And he's there with also a lot of other Youth League members, Southern Cameroonians, taken hostage in 1997.
Why were they caught? What happened? Why were they arrested? And what have they been charged with?
As I said, the Youth League, the league came up with a philosophy that for a long time hasn't been present in the movement for liberation in the former British Southern Cameroons. That philosophy was not just talking, but to actually do, to face the reality of the situation facing our people. Because you see, for a long time, the other organization, a lot of our people, from the days of the Fonchas, right up to the days of, right up to today, a lot of our politicians, those people that I told you that were discussing this struggle in the boardrooms, they had been matching their ideals to the method of the oppressors, failing to know that you have to match ideal to ideal and method to method. And that failed us. The method of our oppressor was to annex us. That was their ideal, to annex us. Their method was to go down to the field, to scatter all of the things that make us a nation, to kill all of those people who stand in their way, to carry on the genocide, to totally subjugate us. They had to use that brutality, that method of brutality. But we were there. We wanted a democratic society. Those are our ideals. We wanted to be free and unfettered, to open our arms and hold all people as brothers. Those are the ideals that we have. We haven't lost those ideals. We also like the democracy. We also like freedom. We also like to welcome people into our house. But you cannot take those ideals and match it to the method of the brutality that we're facing to a people from the oppressors. No. And that is what the youth league came on. That yes, on the matter of democracy and all this, we'll match La République on that. We'll talk to them on that. On the method that they are using on the field to brutalize our people, if needs be, we will also use that those methods in order to stop them. And it is that language, it is that those ideals that forms the youth league, that entails the league.
So what I mean, I'm trying to see why these people you've mentioned are in jail and what have they been charged with?
Yeah, so you see, that was a radical departure from what La République believed an Anglophone to be. Because you see, from our administering authority, we have been conditioned as into a people who have to give in, to be gentle and pliant, to always surrender what was asked from us. That's how we have been conditioned. We have never been taught to act in our own right, to match La République on our own terms. So La République had known the Anglophone to be somebody who just stands and accepts and be gentle, and when you push comes to shove, to push him and he falls back. Until you push him right up to the world, he goes into the world, into the war, or even die without uttering a protest. So with those ideas of the league, it was a radical departure from those cowards that the Francophone believed we were. And so they had to change their tactics on how to face us. That's why they unleashed this brutality on the league and on our people. They took Ebenezer hostage. They killed a lot of our people, taking the others into the league. You understand? The torture that they carried on to them when they were in jail. More than nine of them died. We don't know how many have been killed and buried in unmarked graves. We can never tell. It's only at the end of the day, because there are some mothers and fathers now in the Southern Cameroons believing that their children are in exile while they are in unmarked graves. So when we gain our freedom, before we know the extent of the brutality that the annexers have visited on our people.
So basically, La République has defined that these people are criminals or whatever they want to call them. What do you think they are?
I think that it's not what I think. You understand? It's not what I think. Ebenezer is one of the greatest fight leaders of the former British Southern Cameroons that has ever been. I think he is the greatest because that's the one leader that came up and fought for our people. He came up, he looked at the situation clearly, and he did not allow any illusions to cloud him. Said that this is the situation, this is the remedy, this is what we have to do. That is the first leader of our people that has been that clear and prepared to offer his life for the people of the Southern Cameroons. So there should be no debate, no question, no 1 minute given to any other interpretation of who Ebenezer is. Ebenezer is a leader, is a liberation fighter. Somebody who has fought and is fighting for freedom. And all his letters that he sent out from jail to the British, to the United Nations, to me, to the Youth League, and to the people of the Southern Cameroons, he always make one word, that he fights for Anglophone domination, against Anglophone domination, and he fights against Francophone domination. He just wants simple and unfettered freedom for his people.
What has been the response of his people to his arrest? And I mean, so what are the people of Southern Cameroon doing about his arrest and his imprisonment?
We have this tendency in our land, you see, we have this tendency in our land of over-respecting, of giving so much respect to title holders, the funds, the doctors, the professors. I am not against that. I respect all of them. But that tendency has cost us a lot. It has made us to be subjugated today. It has allowed genocide to be visited on our people. It has allowed our people to be the least, to be almost the last areas in the world today where they can be termed rightfully slaves. Because we give so much stock to titles. And that is the situation that La Republique understands so well. And that is why you see today he will treat Ebenezer like that. Because we cloud ourselves. We say that, oh, this justice is in jail. This doctor is in jail. They are not going to bring freedom for us. It is those boys on the street, those people prepared to go out and die empty-handed, holding olive branches, that are going to bring us freedom. And that is who Ebenezer is. And if we don't radically change the way we perceive who a leader is in our land, we might remain slaves forever. So the reaction of our people to Ebenezer's incarceration, especially to those that you call the intellectual trust of our people, has not been satisfactory, not at all.
There are some people who have argued that we are not strong enough to fight La Republique militarily, and because of that, they have gone out looking for different ways of liberating, or which I assume that's what you call boardrooms. Tell me what you tell those people who truly believe that we don't just have the bone to fight La Republique, and that you are misguided or something like that.
This is a sad situation, because you see, if we can even allow somebody to make such an argument at this late date in our history, if one of our people is even prepared to listen to such message, it's a pity. Because as I tell you, over the years, those are the arguments that have been used to subjugate our people. You see, those are leaders, those masters of our own destiny, who tell you in 1959, when we had independence in our grasp, that we do not have that mind to stand on our own. Yeah, we do not have it. So we went into a union. In 1972, they said, oh no, we cannot stand against Aijo proceeding this because we do not have that mind. They swept over our parliament. Gendarmes were running rampant in our territory. In 1984, those are the, at this date, 40 years after, do we bring such an argument again? Are we that stupid to be accepting such? After 40 years of such arguments, what then? Do we take another 40 years of such arguments? No, we don't have this. No, we don't have that. And what does history tell us? What is it that God teaches us evocatively in the story of David and Goliath? Those are teachings that our people would go to church every Sunday and listen to it and still run away from what God is teaching them. It doesn't, the might doesn't count. God always say that, might doesn't count. He that has truth on his side, he that is standing on the high ground, is always going to win. But you don't expect to sit in your room, to lie on your bed, and you expect that God is going to come and give you the freedom. But our own God is the United Nations. That's what our people are telling us. That is our own God. But the United Nations taught us a lesson that we should learn very, very well. The lesson that they taught us in Kosovo. That you have to go out there and you show them that you cannot accept it anymore. That you are a human being. And that what you believe in, you are prepared to die in before the United Nations would allow its troops to come in and one or two of them to also commit their life for you. If East Timor had sat down and said that, oh, we are a landlocked country, nobody is there to help us. Indonesia has all the mighty navies, one of the best army in Asia, and everything. Had they sat down and bring this baseless argument that cowards want us to believe in, today they will not be free. And when I look at the images of those Indonesians that send the mighty navy and army and jet bombers of the Indonesian military running away with their tails between their legs, you see them barefoot, carrying bow and arrows. I mean, but the most striking thing about those people is when you look in their faces, into that smile beaming out from their eyes and their mouth, the smile of freedom. That's what captivates me about them. So we can do it because other people have done it. We have precedents on our side.
First of all, most of our land has been emptied of its intellectuals and its most productive forces. And they are either in La République or in the diaspora. What's your message, say, to these people who are out of the territory?
The only message that I can send is that, you know, one day, the common man of our people would ask them a simple question. Where were you? Where were you when our land was being consumed like a small and gentle fire, alone, by the forces of hatred, annexation, and brutality? You have to give them an answer. What will be your answer? That you were a coward? Or that you were a patriot? There is no middle ground. and all of us should think. Because not only that, your own son or daughter would also stand one day and ask this question, because I asked it of my own father. What did you do?
What did your father say?
What answer could he give? My father told me that they were some masters of their destiny, that they put their destiny in their hands and they were sold. But today, we have learned a different lesson, that there are no masters of our destiny but ourselves.
Okay.
And we should accept that responsibility, all of us, individually and collectively.
What do you tell the UN?
I'll only tell the... What can I tell the UN that hasn't been told by those our intellectuals, those people who had gone before me, and they are there before me? What more can I add? The only thing I can add is that let the UN and let Britain know that La République du Cameroun, when we stand before God and before man to accuse, it will not be La République du Cameroun accusing for the genocide going on in our territory. Because our people are dying today because of their policies. And they should know that for every one of our citizens that is killed by La République du Cameroun, it is the blood that is flowing in on their head.
On the, who said?
The United Nations and Great Britain.
Okay.
Because of what they did. I know that the United Nations have spoken so much of preventive diplomacy. Britain talked of, the government of Blair talked of ethical diplomacy. Our people are long overdue ethics. And for the United Nations, our people are long overdue preventive diplomacy. But I know that maybe they are waiting for a Rwanda-like situation to occur for them to come and pay lip service. If that's not what they want, they are going to do, then it is more than time for them to come in.
What do you tell La République?
I only tell La République du Cameroun that in physics, when I went to school, I learned that for every action, there is a reaction. And when you put a force, there is an equal and opposite force. And I think that for a long time, our people has accepted said situation and not applied the normal principles of physics. But I think that, you see, it is time, for I can no more live as a slave. I can no more be an inhuman being. I want to accept my place into the community of humans and to accept that I have to fight La République du Cameroun if they want me to fight. If they don't want me to fight, they should accept me as a human being, accept my right to self-determination and sovereignty, and get out of my land peacefully. Would it happen? I don't think so.
Well, we have a neighboring country, Nigeria, and we used to be part of Nigeria governed by the British. Does Nigeria have a role to play in this whole situation in your territory?
You see, what we are trying to do is to make La République du Cameroun into a good neighbor. And to do that, we also have to accept Nigeria as a neighbor, as a good neighbor, you see. But I would not want to believe, especially as things have changed into Nigeria, and Nigeria is now a democracy, you understand? And when you look at the leadership of Nigeria, look at the person at the helm of the leadership is somebody that understand the plight of subjugation, because he moved from jail under Abacha to leadership in his country.
Who are we talking of?
We are talking of Olusegun Obasanjo.
Okay.
And that's somebody that had certain ideals when he was the president the first time under a military regime. He had certain ideals that he tried to instill in his nation by handing over power to a civilian government. And today he has come to make that that ideal a landmark in his nation. And I think that doing that and considering the role that Nigeria as the most populous nation in Africa, I think that that role that Nigeria he played in their history, he should extend it to all people suffering under subjugation. For it wouldn't matter to the Nigerian people to be an oasis in a desert instead of becoming a spring that should water the desert and to bring it into a lush field with flowers. And I think that Nigeria has that role to play as a spring, not as an oasis.
Okay. I know you've addressed the skeptics of force. What do you tell the neutral ones who are sitting on the sidelines, have no opinion, just getting along with whatever comes and one way or the other dying or living?
Who is neutral, sir? Who is neutral in this thing? Is it a sounding Cameroonian that you are talking of, or somebody in Britain, a British citizen or an American citizen?
I'm talking of the neutral Southern Cameroonians who are actually the victims of the situation, and they're willing to go along with it, and they really don't have an opinion one way or the other. They believe in the authority that is ruling them at the time, and that's all, and that's it.
I think that, you see, that is so hard for me to perceive. It's so hard for me to perceive because the Southern Cameroonian, what he faces and what he has faced is so degrading, is so, you know, so obvious that it is shocking to hear you talking about neutral. You see, when a minister stands over national radio and television and talks of les Anglos pas chez vous, les ennemis dans la maison, you see, it's not a certain type, les Biafra, it's not a certain type of people. It is all those people in that territory of the Southern Cameroon. So it's hard for you to be looking that over national CRTV from a minister in a regime ruling the country, and for you to still tell me that you are neutral. You see, the level of economic deprivation that has gone on, and that's one of the cases of the genocide that I'm telling you that they are, you know, propagating against our people. Economic deprivation is so terrible. When you leave from Victoria to go to Bamenda, you have to pass through Littoral and Western Province, two provinces in La République du Cameroun, before you get into Bamenda. Instead from leaving from Victoria to Bamenda direct, you have to pass through two Francophone provinces to get there. But that has been a nation that has existed on itself from 1916 to 1959. Bamenda that way and Victoria that way, without La République. And there was that communication direct through Manfi, you see. And the subtlety in that is so great that when we leave from Victoria, you have to pass through Nkeke. When you reach there, you buy this roasted fish, meat, you eat, spend money so they drain you again before you enter Bamenda. But that's money. If we had had a road as it was before, connecting Victoria to Manfe and Bamenda, that is how our economy would have been growing. You see, but they want to use, they are using it to drain us of the mega resources that they even allow us. So those are situations that I don't understand how an Anglophone can look at it, a Southern Cameroonian can look at it like that and still tell me that it's neutral. How? It's unbelievable.
I'm going to ask you, but before I ask another question, why do you think, with all the horror stories you're telling, why haven't the people of Southern Cameroon revolted like you have?
As I said, it's conditioning. They have conditioned our people. Even today, in what they will tell you, that the SDF, the Social Democratic Party, that's a political party, when you even get Anglophones who stand up and talk as Anglophones, no. Don't bring this, you cause discontent. You know that many of our supporters are Francophones, you see? And that is how they have stifled the Anglophone to always ask us to give, to submit. Always to the Francophone. They will tell you that, no, unité, peace, unité, harmony. That means giving from the Anglophone. And unless we change that mentality, unless we note, we take it, because for us, you see, they come with these smiling faces. And tell them, no, we are brothers. Let us not do this because it will bring discord. But we are just accepting it as face value. We have not looked at it as a stated policy that was set, that people sat down in conclave and decided on. The moment we accept that is a method for subjugation, that's when we can fight it. But we have not yet accepted that. We just look at it as people want the place to be harmonious without this thing. What has it cost us? It has cost us our land, our nation, our freedoms, all of it. And our lives. That's what it has caused us, that harmony.
And how do you reverse that conditioning?
I think that it is a matter of our people, those masters of our destiny. And I say those masters of our destiny, I mean those Southern Cameroonians, Ambazonians, who stand up today as the title holders in our territory. From the fawns to the doctors and the professors, to stop fooling our people, to tell our people clearly what is happening with all honesty and all truth, because all that they have been doing is to help La République in its war, in its ongoing war on us, because they have always used that as their principle. L'amitié, smile with them. Okay, we'll have to go to the boardroom, to the United Nations to do this. We'll have to go to the Hague to do this. We'll have to do that. That is fooling our people. Come to our people, tell them that La République is killing you people. What we have to do is to stop La République in our territory from the rape and the massacres that they are carrying out, and our people who desist will know that they are facing a smiling enemy. Don't come and tell them that. We'll go to the United Nations, and the United Nations is going to send troops. The United Nations did promise to send troops in, to send people into East Timor. When they send it, what happened? When the United Nations organized the referendum in East Timor, what happened? You had the militias and the Indonesian militia that were already on the ground. After the East Timorese voted for their independence, they went on a rampage and the amount of destruction and killing that happened under the United Nations mandate in East Timor had never been seen under the mandate of the East Timor's force of the argument of force. All over those years that they had been fighting for their liberation, had not seen that type of massacre that happened after the United Nations came in and organized a referendum. But it happened. Today, but they are free. And we accept that, and they accept it. Because you cannot eat emulate without breaking eggs. They accepted it. Now, are people prepared to accept that since the United Nations has shown us that even when they come in, the militias will still go on the rampage and the La Republic's and gendarmes and armies in our territory will still go on the rampage? Are they going to accept it? That's the point. We already have such militias existing in Balikumba and in Kumba, the Mukete Gang. They are already there in our territory. The parallels are there in history and in our territory. Let us follow it.
I'm going to ask you a question which anybody listening to you now is going to ask. How are they going to get arms to fight the government of La Republic? How do you answer somebody like that?
Who has talked about arms and who has talked about arms fighting the government of La Republic? I think that we have to gain our sovereignty. And to do that, it means that every Southern Cameroon and Ambazonia should commit themselves to the reality of the struggle. Some people are going to die. Some are not going to die. But everybody has his role. People are already dying. The Ebenezers are in jail. Some of them have already died. The three that were killed in the October 1 manifestation in Kumbu, they are dying. And that is how the blood is flowing in our territory. That's how it is being flown.
You mean so, October 2001?
Yes, 2001. So there are such people already prepared to die for our sovereignty. How do we limit those deaths? Or how do we make those deaths to count if people have to die? Is you and me and all other Southern Cameroonians to be able to come together and look at the organizations that look at this thing clearly in the face and say that La Republic du Cameroun has to be out of our territory, has to be driven out of our territory. Their gendarmes have to be stopped. The massacre, the genocide going on in our territory has to stop. That is what the League stands for. And we have shown that we don't fight in boardrooms. This struggle is on the street. We'll go down on the street. If we are caught on the street, we will be caught. If we are taken to jail, we will go to jail. If we are killed, we will die. But we have to change it. We have to tell the Republic of Cameroon that our people are backing us in such a way that you will come to kill us and you will die if you come to annex all. We are not for any annexation. We will not annex any people. But we will defend ourselves. And the means to defend ourselves lies in our people, in everybody accepting his or her responsibility to look and to contribute what you have to contribute for us to defend ourselves. From 1997 up till now, we have consistently shown that with our determination, we are going to win. We are going to send the gendarmes packing from our territory. Other nations have done it. We can do it. And we will do it.
I have another question for you. There are people who, when they hear you talking about separating Southern Cameroon from La Republique, they are thinking about their families that have intermixed with the citizens of La Republique, their cross marriages and all that. What do you tell those people? Because they now are in one country, they believe they're married to their own citizens, and what you're telling them is that they will soon be married to foreigners. What and how do you explain this? How do you reconcile this vision that you have and the conflict that they would see coming with the sovereignty of Southern Cameroon?
But the percentage that they are intermingled is too minute to weigh against the degradation and genocide going on the majority of the people. That is a logical answer that I can give, as logical an answer that I can go to give without being rude. Because I cannot weigh the life of even a single Southern Cameroonian on the marriage of or the intermingling of any other family. But we have lost a lot of people, and we are continuing to lose a lot because of some people are using such baseless argument to cover the issue that is facing us. The issue that is facing us is the subjugation of one nation by another and the ongoing genocide that is being carried on by that nation on that other nation. What is the central issue here is a matter of justice and a matter of freedom to the people of the British Southern Cameroon. There are many of our citizens that are now citizens of Nigeria. Some are citizens of Great Britain. And they have families both ways. So reasserting our independence doesn't mean that they stop having family in Nigeria, one way or the other. So let there be no fear about that.
There are people like Godjie Dinka who seriously believe that armed struggle will not lead us anywhere, and that what we need to do is go to the international community, go to the International Court of Justice, go to the UN, appeal to the international community to come and liberate us. What do you take from that?
What I would ask is just that let such people with such philosophies go back into history. Let them look at other nations. Let them look at America. The Americans will be the first to tell you that. The blood of martyrs and patriots are the natural manure for the tree of liberty. Because the Americans had to sacrifice a lot of their people in order to be free and liberated. And all the ideas from all these leaders who are talking this, they are looking at the American system, they envy it. And they would like us to believe like the Americans, like the British, like the Germans. But they should know that these nations paid a price for liberty. And if the people of Kosovo had sat down and listened to Ibrahim Rugova, who was rushing around showing papers he had signed with the murderers of his people, Milosevic, in Belgrade, and telling his people that this is the way, if they had sat down quietly and accepted that, the machine of oppression and ethnic cleansing would have achieved its goal in Kosovo. But the Kosovo Liberation Army better understood the true path to freedom, which was, you can't go to the table and talk to people who are out to kill and murder your people. You have to defend your people, your life, because if you don't have any life, then what, at the end of the day, what will you have? What will you defend? You will already be dead. So the question that I am asking these people is, for how long will we keep going up this ladder, designed in hell and brought to our people by the British, the French, and La République du Cameroun, When do we stop going up until we can't come down any longer? Because then it wouldn't matter. Our land would lie in ruin. Our people will be dead. Then what will we have? What will we be fighting for? Because as we speak, that machine of oppression, ethnic cleansing, and genocide is carrying on its work in our land. So we have to design the means to stop that machine before tomorrow our liberty can have any meaning. So I launch this appeal to all Southern Cameroonians, to the FOM, to those in the SENC and Ambazonia, that it is time for us to dodge this issue and to face the reality that is facing us, that our freedom is not going to come from the ICJ or the United Nations. Our people, like all other people, like the Eritreans, like the Kosovars, like the Croatians, like the Americans, like the British, will have to stop the machine of oppression in their land first of all, before they will have their freedom.
What do you, you know, I'm going to ask you this, and I think it's an important question, especially after September 11th. What do you tell people who, when you go fighting for your rights now, they term you terrorists? What are you going to tell them?
Who defines you as a terrorist? Who is it in this thing that you listen? Is it the Taliban regime calling somebody a terrorist? That is the question. Because it will be laughable were it not so sad that La République du Cameroun, the head of La République du Cameroun, Paul Biya, might have the means to term somebody terrorist sitting in front of these organizations like the Commonwealth or the United Nations, when said individual is the greatest terrorist of all. That is the world we live in. How can we change that? I think that it is within the grasp of the international community. Because from everything that is befalling us today, it is being perpetrated by a terrorist government. Because that is a tool that they are using on our people, terrorism. The killing, assassination of people in their jail. They will catch our people, assassinate them in their jail. Some extrajudicially executed. They will go into our lands. People marching in October 1 with olive branches. They will shoot them. They will shoot them down. Throw grenades on armless citizens, maybe cutting the hands off of our people. They will go into our territory and they will explode a chemical weapon to test it. That is the reality that my people face. And it will be so sad for anybody to give such a regime the ear to even term somebody else a terrorist. Those people that have died have not died in vain. Those that are being killed today in Yaoundé will not be dying in vain. Those that are with the oppressors of our people will march in the streets of Boya under shame and scorn, and will keep that shame and scorn on their head. So everybody should decide. Many people are looking at our freedom as, you know, something that is going to take some time, a long time. It is not. Why it has taken this long? It's because we haven't started fighting back. But that's changing, and that will change. And so our freedom is in the corner. So it's time for everybody. As I said, there is no middle ground. Either you are a coward, an anti-patriot, an enemy to our people, or you are a patriot and a friend to our people. No middle ground.
For those who are sitting in jail right now, if you were to communicate to them right now, what would you be telling them?
That what they stood for is alive, because it can never be killed and it can never be put into jail. It can be postponed, yes. It can be made tougher, yes. But it is alive and kicking. Because you can never put freedom into jail. You can never put humanity, you can never kill humanity and freedom. And you can never kill all Southern Cameroonians. There are hundreds and hundreds of people of Southern Cameroonians prepared to die for their freedom. I can only tell them in jail that whether in jail, in a territory, or in exile, no matter the difficulties we face, no matter how desperate our situation can be, we should always sleep with this one fact in our mind, that we will be free. It is non-negotiable, our freedom. And we have the capacity, we have shown the sort of nerve that it will be needed for our people to be free. So we are not afraid. One moment, it doesn't cross our mind. What crosses our mind is, when will we be free? And all of us have a role to play, all Southern Cameroonians. You see, the main thing that blocks our people is the cost of freedom. We should change our thinking, the cost of enslavement. That is what our people should be thinking, not the cost of freedom, but the cost of enslavement. And the cost is enormous. The cost of enslavement is enormous. It has suspended democratic principles. It has suspended human rights. It has suspended economic and social development in our territory. Those are the cost of enslavement. We live under terror today. We live with murderers, marauders, rapists controlling us. Those are the cost of enslavement. That is what should be in the mind of our people, not the cost of freedom. We will have our freedom. Those of our people whose struggle is to fight amongst ourselves, they will tell you that they are patriots. But those are the worst type of cowards and enslavers that we will face. Those of our people who go out to fight our people. There is no one single road to freedom. There are many roads to freedom. And this is a warning that should go to everybody that calls himself a leader to this struggle. We might need partnerships, because nobody has a single solution to this problem. So we should be very careful about where our priorities are. Are we out to deal with La République du Cameroun? Or are we out to play petty politics amongst ourselves? The time for politics is not now. The life of our people the very tenets that makes us a nation are at stake. And that is what we have to be dealing with, not politics. Politics is for sovereign, for nations that are control their sovereignty. A nation is not controlling its sovereignty. So let's forget about politics.